is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my
was broken, but there was no one that I could tell. Praying felt like I was throwing pennies in a wishing well. And I started believing I was cursed to carry this weight. I was listing the reasons of why I should walk away. Until grace called my name. Oh, I didn't know I could be free until grace found.
We got it? All right. Thank you, Andrew. Thank you, thank you. All righty. Well, good morning. Busy, busy. I find out a lot of things. Yeah. And so big Jacob and little Kathleen and the precious, you know, when you see Kathleen, you see two people. And I know the name of that little baby that she's got now. Her name's Autumn. So we're going to be happy to have Autumn come into the world. Also as a precious child of God, isn't that nice? We've got to see I've had the privilege of seeing the family work through situations with jobs and stuff like that. And I can tell you that family is honoring the Lord Jesus Christ because they're putting their family first, and God will allow that job opportunity to fit right in, guys. I promise you He will, because that is in agreement with the Lord to take care of His precious children that He gives you. Look, I'm telling you, it's right in agreement with the Lord. I was saying, I can't see this. Well, there's a reason. So anyway, we turn to the letter of Philippians that Paul writes. Paul was in prison, and he's writing a letter, and he's so filled with joy from the Lord. And he affirms to them, and I'll just start with the first chapter, of course. He says, it's from Paul and Timothy. We are bondservants of Christ Jesus. And he says to all the saints, and sometimes people have a difficult time with that word saint, but you are saints. It came from Hagamos. You're holy. Your position in Christ is whole and without blame because you've been hidden in Christ with God. And he says, grace to you and peace from God our Father, the Lord Jesus Christ. And he says, I thank my God in all my remembrance of you, always offering prayer with you with joy in my every prayer. And it says, in view of your participation of the gospel from the first day until now, and I love verse 6. It's a verse that I keep close when I try to do things in my own power, and I remember this. And Paul says, for I am confident of this very thing, that God, who began a good work in you, He will perfect it until the day of Christ Jesus. Today we're going to be talking about the power source that we have. Where does it come from as we transform into the likeness of Christ? Many times we try to do it on our own, and trying to do it on our own, many times we try to do things to please God so He'll love us. I want us to reestablish this in our minds. I want you to affirm that God loves you. Just let that sit in your heart. He loves you. There's nothing you can do to break the bond of love that God has for you. There's nothing you can do that He will condemn you, because He has hidden you in Christ with Him. And He sees you. He sees you robed in the beautiful righteousness and the forgiveness that Christ provided for you. So what we do is in honor and love for Him. So I'm going to let you into my life younger, when I tried to go into doing things for Him hoping He loved me. And my learned behavior was, if I perform, he'll be kind and good to me. And the day I found out, oh my, He loves me, regardless of what I do, so I can just do anything I want to do? No. Now I want to do things that please Him. Jay still does. I'm trying to work on him. But, and the reason I named Ellis, Willis and Ellis, Willis is the bad guy. Ellis is the good guy. Anyway, no, I'm kidding. Let me pray for us. It's good to be in the house of the Lord. Father, we love you and we thank you. And Father, let our motivation, Father, for serving you because of the beautiful works of love that you did for us. Father, it's not a duty, it's a desire and a pleasure. So Father, guide our hearts directed towards you. Father, let us put on the mind of Christ. And Father, let us do only those things that He's done. And Father, change our thinking, that your thoughts may be our thoughts, that may be your desires as we walk this earth. And Father, reinstill with each one of us the understanding of the deep love that you have for us that can never be taken away. So Father, have us rearrange our life in such a way, Father, that we know we're truly loved by you and we don't have to perform, we don't have to do anything, Father, except what you desire for us to do. Help us to focus on that, Lord. Father, I thank you for Ellis and Kathy and all the people here, Father, that help put the worship music together, Father. And Father, my prayer is that, Father, that they will let go of anything they've got, and Father, let it all be you. Let their hearts, Father, be praising you, and the others just join in. So, Father, we want to give you a beautiful, Father, aroma of praise and worship and honor, Father, because you're building a spiritual house, a holy priesthood, Father, that will sacrifice themselves to you. And today, Father, we sacrifice our praise and worship in honor of you. We're offering it to you, Lord. Thank you. For it's in Christ's name I pray. Amen and amen.
The first song we're singing this morning is "To God Be the Glory," and it says, "To God be the glory. Great things he hath done. So loved he the world that he gave his son, who yielded his life as atonement for sin and opened the life gates that all may come in." Let's all stand and sing that together.
To God be the glory, great things he hath done. So loved he the world that he gave us his Son, who yielded his life an atonement for sin, and opened the life gate that all may come in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done. Oh, perfect redemption, the purchase of blood, to every believer the promise of God. The vilest offender who truly believes that moment from Jesus a pardon receives. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done. Great things he has taught us, great things he has done, and great our redemption through Jesus the Son. But purer and higher and greater will be our wonder, our transport when Jesus we see. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done.
Amen.
And this next song is "How Long Has It Been?" And this has got a, listen to the words to this, it's got great, great words to it. And then Kathy brought that to me and said, let's learn this one together. So it's kind of a new one to me in a little bit, but we've enjoyed singing it together.
Yeah.
How long has it been since you talked with the Lord and told him call him your friend? How long has it been since you knew that he cares for you? How long has it been since you knelt by your bed and prayed to the Lord up in heaven? How long since you knew that he'd answer you and would keep you the long night through? How long has it been since you woke with the dawn and felt like the day's worth the living? Can you call him your friend? How long has it been since you knew that he cares for you? Can you call him your friend? How long has it been since you knew that he cares for you?
Thank you. You may be seated.
Where's my little guys? Thank you, Ellis. Thank you, Kathy. Come on, little Soph. Come on. There you go. Brinley and little Sammy and Miss Catherine and Autumn. Oh, you got a little belly bump there, girl.
Coming in.
Coming in hot, man. Coming in. Coming in for two. Steady as you go. Brinley. You want to get up here and show Brinley. Earth to Brinley. There we go. You want to get up here and show them what you do? Come on, twirl for it. Watch her. She wanted to do this for y'all. Go for it. There you go. Yay, that's good. Yeah, that's good. Twirling for the Lord. Uh-oh. Sammy, I won't look at. There you go. You got, oh, there you go. All righty. How's everybody been? Sophie, you have anything you want to pray about, hon? What, tell me. Pray to Jesus, okay. Brinley, how about you? Yeah? You want to pray for your grandma and grandpa? No? Leave the building. No. I bet we pray for Sammy. Okay, we'll do that. How about you? Landon, how about you? Pray you get out of the flowers. How's that? Sammy? What you want to pray for, honey? That the pastor doesn't look at you because you'll cry? Okay, let me pray for these precious children. Father, what a joy, Father, that we get to see such innocence, Father, made in your image and your likeness, Father. They're so precious, Father. And Father, it's beautiful to know that the truth of you, with what you say, Father, that you believe that we're precious too, Father. And Father, being in your likeness and your image, Father, may we continue to grow more and more and to transform into the likeness of Christ, Father. And doing so, Father, may these children see the beauty of you and may be glorified, Father, that we will glorify you, Father, by having these beautiful children see the beautiful works on display in us that you've put through us. So, Father, let them see that. Father, let them grow up in a way, Father, that they will identify with you. Father, they'll have their acceptance and they'll have their self-esteem and value in Christ and they'll have and note the power of the Holy Spirit within them. Father, teach us to love them like you do. Father, I pray for the parents. Father, for the new precious little Autumn that's going to be born. I pray for little Olivia, Father, and little Lucas, Father, as they're home with Mom and they're not feeling good, Father. Lift their spirits and Father, send our love to them through you, Father, that they will know that they're just loved, Father. Father, we just love you, Father, and thank you for the privilege, Father, of raising these little princes and princesses, Father, in your name that I pray, Father, in the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. Okie dokie. We'll see, y'all. Uh-oh, I got it. Don't worry. You got it, hon? There you go. You got it? There you go. Yeah, I get it. That's okay. Kids tearing the stage up. So is Heather's gone? Yeah. What I want to do this morning is have a time of prayer for anyone that would feel like they need prayer. If you need, got it, Lucas? Anyway, we want to be known as a church that prays for one another. I've got someone we'll be praying for, Zach. I know that y'all, I don't know if y'all remember him or not, the young man that's about 17, 18 years old now, I guess. He's had one battle with cancer and had a 10% chance of making it, according to the doctor, but the Lord said, you got 100% chance with me. So he got through that, and now they've found some more cancer in one of the lungs, and they may have to remove a lung in this 18-year-old boy, but... Talked to him yesterday, went by and saw him. He's scared, and I prayed with him and lifted him up to the Lord and held his hand, and he asked me, he said, am I going to be all right? And I said, yeah, Zach, you're going to be all right because you know Jesus. He said, am I going to make it through this? I said, I don't know. But I'll be with you till you do, and then I'll be with you after I'm gone too. So let's just focus on the Lord and what he'll do for us. And I said, Zach, let the Lord's work be displayed in your life so that your mother and your father and your brothers can see the beauty of Christ in you as you go through this. And I said, Zach, that's easy for me to say. But, brother, I'm with you. And I just love you, and I'm just here. So I want to lift him up in prayer, too. Anybody else, pray for your loved ones, or we'll pray for Catherine and Jacob, the baby is coming. Anyone else have any prayer requests? Go ahead, Kathy. Yeah.
But
pray for you, honey.
My God is able. I had a heart attack at 49. I should have died. And I'm 64. And God has watched over me and kept me here for reasons that I never understood until sometimes he shows me. But I love you all.
Yeah.
And I appreciate your prayer.
Yeah. Pray for Kathy.
I know he's able.
Father, we lift Kathy, Father. Father, I don't lift her up. You've already got her in her in your hands, Father. And I thank you for a husband, Rich, Father, that has a love for her that will help her get through this. And Father, when the doctor says that they can do no more, Father, it doesn't mean you can't do any more, Father, because nothing's impossible with you. Father, I pray for the body to be healed, Father. But I pray for the mind, Father, to be at peace. Father, I pray for the works of you to show beautifully, and they've just done so in the works of Kathy, Father. Father, although we may have a little bit of insecurity and fear, Father, you'll fill that void in our life. So, Father, the doctors that she may be seeing, Father, give them wisdom, give them guidance. But, Father, let Kathy know, and she knows, Father, that you've got this, and you'll walk with her through this. And, Father, may it draw her so close and near to you. Father, I pray for Zach, Father. Pray for that precious young man. Father, thank you for the opportunity, Father, that I got to be with him, that you let me do that. Father, it's such a privilege to see a young man, Father. Father, I drew my strength from you through him, Father, to just sit there, Father, and as my mind just said, oh, Lord, please, please. Father, my begging started turned into, Father, glorify and honor yourself in this, Father. And Father, the young man brought me closer to you yesterday, and I thank him for that. Father, we go through difficult times, Father, and Father, remind us not to go through it without you. Father, let's put you in the front so that we can walk behind you and you can shield us. Father, I pray for Anna Mae. Father, it's only been 4 or so months, Father, since Jack has gone to be with you, Father, and you've seen him face to face, Father. So now, Father, fill that void with your love for Anna Mae, Father. Father, you'll instruct her, Father, on how to work through this. But Father, let her work through it in a beautiful way, again, that honors and glorifies you. Father, may we gather around her and help her. Father, pray for Pearl. Father, she misses her kiddos, Father, and she misses her husband, Father, her husband that passed away. So, Father, there's a great void in our lives and many people's lives here, Father, and that gives opportunity for you just to fill it up, Father, with your precious beauty and love and goodness and kindness and joy. So, Father, let's not miss an opportunity, Father. Let us not waste that pain, Father. Let us bring it to you, Father, so you can put the Band-Aid and the balm of Gilead upon it, Father, to soothe our souls and our hearts, Father. Father, thank you for the opportunity and the privilege, Father, of being loving these people, Father, as you've instructed me to, Father. Father, I need your wisdom. I need your strength. I need your guidance in all of it, Father. So I've got to lean on you, Father, because I can't do it on my own. I do it within your power, and I know it's there. Father, I continue to pray for each one here. Father, each one has their own event going on, Father. Father, I pray that they will invite you, Father. They will have a yieldness, Father, to give up their fight and join your battle. Father, you're fighting the way for us. So, Father, let us lead you. You lead us, Father, and direct us as we do that. Father, I pray for each one here as we open our hearts to hear your word. Father, may you be glorified. May your excellent reputation be honored by what we do. Father, we're here to praise and worship you. And Father, we love you as always. We just love you, love you, love you. For it's in Christ's name I pray. Amen and amen. Wow. One of these days Oh, there we go. Oh, we'll learn not to walk in front of that thing, right? That's good right there. I won't learn that. You know that. Anybody seen any notes of a sermon? Are there? Thank you, Ellis. Thank you, Willis. I'm sure glad y'all have me, because I don't think anybody else would put up with me. Wonderful thing to do. We've been going through a series, what I call the Glory to God series, Glory Be to God series. And we started off with the creation of mankind, male and female. We looked at glory. We looked at what that meant. We went through the scripture and see that. So now, as we continue to walk with our Lord, we're going to look at the power needed for pleasing and glorifying our Lord. The power needed for pleasing and glorifying our Lord. Now may the God of peace, who brought up from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, and ratified an eternal covenant with his blood, may he equip you with all you need for doing his will. May he produce in you, through the power of Jesus Christ, every good thing that is pleasing to him. All glory to him forever and ever. Amen. In one of the passages I left off of this that I put on my sheet earlier is Philippians 1:6 that we read earlier, and it says, "And I am certain that God, who began a good work within you, will continue his work until it is finished on the day when Jesus Christ returns." So we need to see the power that's needed for pleasing and glorifying God. So over the past 5 weeks, we've searched Scripture seeking God's truth. We looked at why God created us in his image and likeness. What is the purpose he created us in his likeness? And how are we to please him in all that we do? And we found that God created us for his own glory, for his own honor, for his praise, because of his excellent reputation. Out of his independence, meaning no outside influence, no inside influence, no need to consult anyone or anything, out of his independence, God speaks of you and me, his sons and daughters, from the ends of the earth as those whom I have created for my glory. And therefore, we are to do all to the glory of God, whether we eat or whether we drink, to the glory of God. Because we are united with Christ in union with Him, we've received an inheritance from God, and He makes everything work out according to the purposes of His plan. You might think, well, Pastor, if that's so, what is His purpose of His plan? Let's turn to Ephesians 1, verse 12, and see what God's answer is. Look at this. God's purpose, here it is, was that we, all believers, the Jew and the Gentile, who trust in Christ, would what? Bring praise and glory to God. That's our purpose. We find God is greatly pleased seeing His children being transformed into the likeness of His Son. And just for a minute, allow me to address, or better yet, allow me to take us to God's word regarding our pleasing Him and Him alone, thus glorifying Him and Him alone. I'm going to back this up a little bit. There we go. Turn with me or read along with me on the screen or in your notes in Galatians chapter 1. Look, Galatia was not a city. It was a territory. And Galatia encompassed an area that is now what we call modern-day Turkey. And several churches were founded there by the Apostle Paul in this area. And it didn't take long after the founding of said churches in Galatia that they were attacked. Now, following Paul's evangelistic efforts through the areas and the founding of these churches, there were men who came in behind Paul with an agenda of their own. Their purpose was to pervert the gospel that Paul had taught, being the gospel, of course, of grace through faith and not of works. These men began to preach another gospel, which is not a gospel at all. Their false gospel was demanding that they must follow. They were demanding they must follow certain rules and regulations, be obedient to the law, and keep the law of God to be righteous. So God the Holy Spirit has the Apostle Paul write to the churches in Galatia to correct this pleasing of men, not honoring or glorifying God. And it starts out, this is a letter from Paul, an apostle. I was not appointed by any group of people. I wasn't appointed by any group of human authority, but by Jesus Christ Himself and by God the Father who raised Jesus from the dead. All the brothers and sisters here join me in sending the letter to the churches of Galatia. May God the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ give you grace and peace. Jesus gave His life for our sins, just as God our Father planned, in order to rescue us from this evil world in which we live. All glory to God forever and ever. Amen. Then he starts out in a correction. He says, I'm shocked that you're turning away so soon from God, who called you to Himself through the loving, see that? The loving mercy of Christ. You're following a different way that pretends to be the good news, but it is not the good news at all. You are being fooled by those who deliberately twist the truth concerning Christ. Let me pause here to let you in on my struggles in trying to please God under my own strength. I refer to it as a legalistic relationship with God, or my religious relationship with God. I lived confused for many years as a youth in a legalistic relationship with God. At the time, I didn't realize that my relationship was legalistic. I just knew it seemed difficult. It was very labor-intensive and not satisfying. It never seemed that I was ever able to measure up. I was religiously trying to follow the rules. I was trying to follow the regulations. I was looking for the approval of others to determine if I was good enough to serve God. How am I doing? Was it okay what I did? Are you approving what I'm doing? Did you read your Bible today? Did you pray, Mike? Did you witness to everyone you saw today, Mike? Did you cheat on your schoolwork today? Of course I did. Did you cheat on your schoolwork today? Were you a good boy and not tell fibs? Would be the question I ask all the time. Of course I said yes, but I just lied to them after being asked if I didn't tell a lie. On and on. I will not do this. I will not do that. Talk about confusing. I was on a performance wheel. You ever seen that hamster running around in the wheel? Where does he get? Nowhere. Why did I act this way? Because unknowingly, I wanted to please them, and in doing so, was thinking God would be pleased with me, and He would, hear this, He would love me. I was hoping God would love me if I did enough for Him. Hogwash. I was exhausted by the rules and regulations imposed on me by others who actually believed, and many still believe, that this is the way to obtain a close walk in relationship with God. However, I stand here today, and I praise to God that He allowed this to happen in my life. Father, thank You for allowing that to happen. because he took my way and said, that's not going to work. You're going to be frustrated. I found this out later, of course. You're going to be confused, and you're going to be always trying to earn my favor and earn my love. I stand here today and praise for God that he took me through that. You may think, well, Pastor, that sounds a little crazy. Why are you praising God for all this that happened? Because of my frustration, of my trying to please man's religious decrees, I came into the knowledge of the grace of God through the love acts of Jesus Christ. How so, Pastor? Let me tell you what happened. God sent a man my way. This man saw my frustration as he too had experienced the effects of attempting to please God under a legalistic relationship. He simply made a declaratory statement in the form of a question, changing and transforming my motive for serving God forever. He always called me Michael. He said, Michael, he said, I'll never forget it. And he paused and he said, monster of a man. And I'm just a kid down there. And he says, Michael, he says, you know Jesus loves you, right? I said, of course I do, was my response. I thought, you crazy old man. He loves me for all I'm doing for him. I am doing it for him to love me. Then he continued and says, why don't you just let Jesus love you based on what he's done for you and you love him back? Why don't you try that? I did. This man freed me from the grip of the do's and the don'ts of man's way into the love relationship of God's way. That's where he took me. Amazing discovery. God really loves me. And rather than a legal relationship with God, I began to allow the love of God flowing through this son of my, through his son, my Savior Jesus Christ, to develop my heart into a loving relationship with him. God led me to scripture verifying he loves me. Romans 8, 34 through 39, he said, Mike, who's going to condemn you? Not me. No one. Mike, Christ died for you and was raised to life for you, and he's sitting in the place of God's right hand, pleading for you. Mike, can anything separate you from Christ's love? Does it mean he no longer loves us if we have trouble or calamity? Do you think that, Mike? Or if you're persecuted, or if you're hungry, or destitute, or in danger, or threatened with death, Mike? No, despite all these things, there's an overwhelming victory in ours through Christ, Mike, who loves you. Mike, I'm convinced that nothing can ever separate us from the love of God. Not your death, Mike, nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither our fears for today or our worries about tomorrow, not even the powers of hell, Mike, can separate you from my love. Boom. I am loved. You know, that has you operate in a whole different system if you're loved. You're motivated by what he's done for you and the great love he has for you. You identify in him. You've been accepted. You have a value. You have a power that everyone searches for, and you find it in Christ Jesus. God delivers and fills the void in those areas. I got to tell you, I've been happy ever since. I found true love, a love beyond all my failure of do's and don'ts. So God's love lifted me, and God's love alone would be my motivation for serving him. One might think, oh, Pastor, that's good, and I see you can do anything you want to, huh? Well, yes, I can. However, I just do not desire to do useless tasks anymore in hoping to please God so he will love me. That is final. That is finished. That is capite, or whatever that word is in French. Caput, what is, cap, no, that, anyway, finished. I have a hard enough time with the English language. What am I trying to do with another language? Look, God loves me not for anything I've done or will do, but for what he has done for me. I love, now live a life, more structured life in this loving relationship with God than I ever did in a legal relationship with God. How so, Pastor? You see, there's something about me and about rules. I don't like them. If I walk by a sign that says, don't touch, I'm going to want to touch it. Even if it's wet paint, is it dry? You know, that's the excuse. About don't walk on the grass, I'll want to step in the grass without getting caught. There's something within me that sort of rebels against rules. But in the loving relationship I have with God, I do not walk on the grass when told not to. I do not touch the sign that tells me not to touch. Why? Because a relationship that's now based on what God has done for me in love transformed my desires to be his desires. His unconditional love motivates me to honor and glorify him in all things that I do. Do I fail? Sure I do. But his love doesn't go away. It's there, and it provides me the grace and opportunity to walk with him again. I promise you, a loving relationship with God is far superior to the legal relationship with God, hoping God will love you if you can please him. See, the love of God will set you free from the law of man's religion. I'll get back to the letter written to the churches founded by Paul, because now this gospel that these following Paul were proclaiming in was an attempt to put the believers in the founded churches in Galatia into a legal relationship with God. Paul had shown up and shown them the grace and the beauty and the mercy of the Lord Jesus Christ, that by faith they were saved. Here comes the law dogs in there saying, you know what? That may be fine and dandy, but this is what you better do. We're going to put you back in a legal relationship, and we're going to put the chains of the law around you again. Those chains were broken by the grace and love of Christ, and now we're going to chain you up again. So Paul said it's not really another gospel. It's a perversion of the gospel they were presenting. So in verses 8 through 24, he says, let God's curse fall on anyone, including us or even an angel from heaven, who preaches a different kind of good news than the one we preach to you. I say again what we've said before. If anyone preaches any other good news other than the one you've welcomed, lead that person, let that person be cursed. And here it is. Remember earlier we briefly mentioned our pleasing God or pleasing others? Look what Paul does. He states the obvious. Verse 10, obviously, I am not trying to win the approval of people, but I am of God. If pleasing people were my goal, I would not be Christ's servant. How this world is filled with people trying to please another person, that they'll be valued and accepted. I'm telling you, in the word of the Lord Jesus Christ, in the biblical form of truth, only truth, that you are loved and you need to please no one but God himself. You get your identity from him. You get your love from him. You get everything from him because he's supplying it all. So you won't morph into something that someone needs you to be, so you'll be okay and be accepted. That's probably the most important lesson that we could teach the younger children that we have here is you need to know that you're accepted. You need to know you're loved. You need to know you're valued. And you need to know that the power of the Holy Spirit will be growing in you. Look to the Lord Jesus Christ to feel that in your life. Obviously, Paul says, I'm not trying to win any approval of the people, but of God. If pleasing people were my goal, I wouldn't be Christ's servant. He next expounds on this truth of receiving the message spoken from God. He says, dear brothers and sisters, I want you to understand that the gospel message I preach is not based on mere human reasoning. Then where'd you receive it, Paul? Where'd you get it? He says, I received my message from no human source and no one taught me. Instead, I received it by direct revelation from Jesus Christ. You know what I was like back then. I followed the Jewish religion, how I violently persecuted God's church. I did my best to destroy the church of God. I was far ahead of my fellow Jews in my zeal for the traditions of my ancestors. See who he was pleasing? He was pleasing his people around him in pursuit of destroying the gospel. He was pleasing the lawgivers. He was given the credit of being the most zealous one among them. He was far ahead of all the rest. But even before I was born, God chose me, called me by his marvelous grace, and it pleased him to reveal his son to me that I would proclaim the good news about Jesus to the Gentiles. He said, when this happened, I didn't rush out to consult with any human being, nor did I go up to Jerusalem to consult with those who were apostles before I was. Well, what'd you do, Paul? Look here. Instead, I went away to Arabia, and later I returned to the city of Damascus. Then 3 years later, I went to Jerusalem. I went to get to know Peter, and I stayed with him for 15 days. Then the only other apostle I met at the time was James, the Lord's brother. I decided then before the Lord that what I am in writing to you is not a lie. After that visit, I went north to the provinces of Syria and Cilicia, and still in the churches in Christ that they are Judea, did not know me personally. Look at this. And they knew, and all they knew was that people were saying, this is the one who used to persecute us and is now preaching the very faith he tried to destroy. You don't think that gospel doesn't change a man? Night and day, old nature, new nature, walking with the Lord. I want you to look at the result of pleasing God and not man. Look at the result in being motivated by the love of God and not by performance and hoping to be loved. Look who gets the glory and honor and praise of one being a servant of a loving Savior, representing him on earth. It's given in the last part of verse 24. Look at this. And they praise God because of me, said Paul. Write that. I want people to praise God because I'm loving and honoring him. Highlight on God, not us, are praising and honoring him. They did not praise Paul. They praised and glorified God. In our time left, if you and I are going to fulfill our purpose of being created in the likeness of God, we must identify the power source provided for pleasing God and glorifying God. In the letter to the Hebrews, we find a benediction, a prayer, and it sheds light theologically on how God is pleased with his children. So important. We also find this power to do so. Look at this. Hebrews 13:21. Now may the God of peace, who brought up from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, and he ratified an eternal covenant with his Christ's blood, May he, God the Father, equip you with all you need for doing his will and desire. May he produce in you, through the power of Jesus Christ, every good thing that is pleasing to him. All glory to him forever and ever. Amen and amen. Do you see in the above passages who is doing the transforming? Do you see in the passage who's doing the equipping? Do you see who's doing the producing? It is not us. It is the God of glory. And it's pleasing to God for us to continually be transformingly, increasingly into the likeness of Christ, thus producing in his honor of his excellent reputation, his glory forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord desires that his works might be displayed in us to his glory. Hear me out, please. Our power to please God, honor God, thus glorifying God, comes from him. No other source. If he's going to complete the work in us, he's got to be the one that supplies the power, the transforming, the way that we are to go, and you cannot do it on your own power. Even Jesus' own examples, I've got to say this carefully, even Jesus' own examples, perfect and powerful as they are, cannot in themselves enable us to follow in his footsteps. We need more than the example. The writer calls on God to make possible the outworking of this truth in the lives of his people, and of course, you and me. The attempt to live a Christian life with the purest doctrine and the finest examples, especially being Jesus Christ, without God's direct power, is to build with wood and hay and straw, and it will be burned up. Not in hell, in the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ at the Bema Seat. It'll be something you pulled off yourself. He'll have no part of. He wants to see the works that he's displayed in you, that he's prepared for you before the foundation of the world. It all must be done under the power of our Lord and Savior. We not only need to know God's will and desire, but we need to have his power to do his deeds, his way, and his time. We need the God of peace to equip us in every good thing to do his will, his desires for us. So God gives us what? His ethics, his morals, his conscience, and he gives us the power to follow them, to live them out. Our Christian growth and obedience have nothing to do with our own power. Our Christian growth and obedience have nothing to do under our own power, but everything to do with God's power delivering in us. It's all glory to God. Our growth and obedience are by God's power, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight through Jesus Christ. Look, the greatest display of divine power in the history of the universe was at the resurrection of Jesus Christ. When God brought him up from the dead, the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the eternal covenant. And God is the God of peace, in that he established peace with us through the blood of the cross. So the sacrifice of the blood of Jesus Christ our Lord is eternally powerful and satisfactory to God. He appeased, fulfilled the propitiation of God. He was the propitiation. He stopped the wrath of God to his beautiful people because the final sacrifice was given. And all those that come to the Father through the Son will have eternal life and have been forgiven and have the righteousness cloak placed upon them, if they can stand before the presence of God. It is the God of this power and the power of this God that enable those who love him to do his will. And if you don't have it figured out that you're loved right now, totally by God, you will walk in a crippled state through your life, hoping you can do the right things to please him, that you'll be loved. Get that out of your head. You are loved. Now go do the things that please him. It's a whole different motivation. What's motivating you to live for the Lord? Is it the great beauty of the works that he's done for you and his son, Jesus Christ? Or is it the great beauty of the works you think you're going to do? They don't mix. It's by the power of God. It is the God of this power and the power of this God that lives within us that will enable us who love him to do his will. Look at 2 Corinthians 3:5, and it's beautiful. Paul says, not that we are adequate in ourselves to consider anything as coming from ourselves, but our adequacy is from God, from our Lord. The thing we must contribute to the Christian life is this. I think I might have made this word up. Is a willing, here's the word, yieldedness. I don't know if that's in the dictionary or not, but it's in ours now. We need to have a willing yieldedness in obedience to the power and the person of Christ. Trust and obey, for there's no other way. Place your eyes upon Jesus, and the world will go strangely dim. And you know the rest of the words. All we must do is open the channel of our will and let God's power work through us. We are the conduit. He's the live wire through us. Look at who and whose power is at work in us. And look at his work and his power provides to the one who gives it. Look at this. God is at work in us both to will and to work. Whose good pleasure? His good pleasure in us. What's the power source? God. He's at work in us. Why? Because he's going to complete what he began until the day of Jesus Christ when we be completed perfectly. God is at work in you and me to will and to work his good pleasure for us. His desires for us are written upon our heart, and we walk those out with the Holy Spirit. They've been designed for us before the foundation of the world. Ephesians 2:10, quote it quite often. You've been placed in union with Jesus Christ that you would do those things that he has prepared for you to do before the foundation of the world. So when you get up the next tomorrow morning, Lord, what have you prepared for me? Holy Spirit, guide me and let me be the example that I may honor and glorify you under your power and your guidance and your direction. See, because Christ does the work, he deserves the credit and the praise. To whom, here we go, be the glory forever and forever. Amen. That, my brothers and sisters, is how to please our God of love and the God of glory. Because he loved me first, I loved him. There was nothing attractive about me, but yet his love lifted me. And now if I'm focused on the love and the work he's done for me, let me tell you, that's attractive. I never had anybody lay down their life for me. Have you? He laid his life down for us. Now, pick it up. As you died with him and arose with him, now let's walk with him. And let's give God the honor and the glory and the praise he deserves. Let's pray. Father, we thank you, Father, for the beautiful redemption, Father, that you planned. Father, it had nothing to do with us except we were the recipients of the forgiveness and the righteousness and the love of your Son, Jesus Christ, you sent to die for us in our place. Now, Father, please let us see that we have died with him. We've risen with him, and now, Father, we're walking the new life with him. And that new life, Father, is based on the motivation of the love that you had for us. And that love, Father, may we never forget how deeply we're loved and how precious we are to you. And may that motivate us, Father, to do those beautiful things you've planned for us to glorify you. Father, to you, all the glory and the honor forever and ever. Amen and amen.
Let's all stand together and sing, "Oh, How I Love Jesus." There is a name I love to hear. I love to sing its worth. It sounds like music in my ears, the sweetest name on earth. It tells me of a Savior's love who died to set me free. It tells me of His precious blood, the sinner's perfect plea. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because He first loved me. It tells me what my Father hath in store for every day. And though I tread a darksome path, Your sunshine all the way. It tells of one whose loving heart can fill my deepest woe, who in each sorrow bears a part that none can bear below. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because He first loved me.
All right, thank you, Ellis and Kathy. Kathy, you keep singing, you be healed. That's good stuff, honey. Anyway, God bless y'all. I love you very much. Holler at me during the week if I can help you in any way. I'll do whatever I can under the power of the Lord Jesus Christ to help. My power is no good. His is great. It works well. So God bless you, and I love you very much. Y'all have a good rest of the day.
Your hand stretches over us. We're covered by your shadow. Your hand is what we can trust through the wild. Your arm reaches out to us. We're sheltered by your power. Your voice is what we can trust in the wild. And the fierceness of the waters, the head of waves, every ripple in the ocean is calling my name. And even in the storm, I won't be afraid. Your sovereign head remains. 'Cause you
cause you are a mountain to the hill.
Never be more loved than I am right now. Wasn't holding you up, so there's nothing I can do to let you down. It doesn't take a trophy to make you proud. I'll never be more loved than I am right now. Ooh.
Going through a storm, but I won't go down. I hear your voice carried in the rhythm of the wind to call me out. You would cross an ocean, so I wouldn't drown. You've never been closer than you are right now.
Let's sing it loud, y'all.
You are Jireh. You are enough.
So clear what it's all about.
So stay by my side when the sun goes.